Merry Christmas and Happy New Year, everyone, and welcome to the service of worship, Knox United Church, on this January 3rd, 2021. I'm the Reverend Linda Petrides, and it's my privilege to be with you today. I hope that you're comfortable where you are and that you're open to God's Spirit, which surrounds us all in every time and every place. Reverend Bright Yun, our minister, is away on a well-deserved break, and he'll return next week. Thank you to everyone who's taking part in today's service. We are still in the season of Christmas, which started on December 25th, of course, 12 days of Christmas, and we're now on day 10. So we begin our service by lighting the Christ candle to acknowledge God's presence with us. We also light our memorial candles in memory of those we hold dear to our hearts. I hope you find the service meaningful and that you receive the blessing that you need.
Lantern ones in ancient times were guided by a star. We seek God's guidance in our lives, and we look for a sign of God's presence in many different places. We look through the inspiration of teachers and mentors, through the stewardship of cooperation and countries, through the nurture of family and loved ones. We need to be led in our time and in our place to new beginnings of hope and goodwill. Inspire us, God, and lead us into our future.
Let us pray. O God of time and space, who in placing the world, the sun, the moon, and the stars in orbit, gave us time. We begin another week, another year with you. Each week has its routines. Then you come, and we are called to something new, something creative. Come to us this day. Call us out of the ordinary and the routine. Call us by your word and presence to what may be. Help us to answer your call in Christ's name. And now, in the language of your choice, let us join our voices in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Happy New Year, everyone! Happy 2021! How are you? Welcome. Welcome to church this morning. Oh, it's a cool, crisp January morning. New Year is just freshly started. Wow. Well, I'm glad we're together. Really glad we're together. You know, this morning, I kind of thought about a time capsule because, you know, as we just welcomed in 2021, it's been a lot of time in the last week, week and a half, 2 weeks to reflect. You know, as we're about to change into the new year, you can't help but look back on what's all happened in 2020. What a year to remember, right? Absolutely. And, you know, as we look ahead now to 2021, as we're visioning ahead, it kind of makes you excited with anticipation of what could be. But it's also, I want to hold on to what kind of was, because as challenging as 2020 was and still is to this day, there's a lot there too to remember and to hold on to that we need to take further. And what I mean by that is a time capsule. You ever heard of one of those? Have you ever made one? Have you ever done one with your family or maybe at school or with friends? It's kind of an interesting thing. You know, time capsules are created in order to capture a moment in time. You know, it's something we think of, things that we want to preserve, that we want to remember, that we want to put in something and not touch for a long period of time, so that when we open it, we're just embracing kind of what was, the memories of that specific time or that time, that year, or that era, or that moment, whatever the capsule may be as to why you created it. So I thought, you know what, Knox? Why can't we create a time capsule? You know, this doesn't need to be one where we need to think of things to put inside, like your favorite, I don't know, CD or your favorite DVD or your favorite piece of jewelry. Not those kinds of things. But I thought about, why not create a time capsule of memories, of things you want to hold on to from this past year? And what I thought is, you know, take one of your Christmas bags that you've got kind of maybe still lying around before you put everything back away again. This Christmas bag I used last Sunday in my moment of discovery time, my Newfoundland dog one. I thought, you know what? I still have a little purpose for this before I kind of put it back in all the wrapping paper and stuff. I thought, you know what might be kind of neat? I'm going to put in some items in here and then I'm going to seal it up and I'm going to then pack it away where I won't be touching it for another year. And how amazing it might be to then open it up and find what I put inside that'll help me reflect on what this year was all about. So what I'm talking about is just using some simple, you know, little pieces of paper and pen or pencil. And what are some things you might want to put inside to remember? Well, 2020 was the year that my stepfather, whom a lot of you know, Paul Wesley, passed away. And, you know, I'm going to write down the date and the time and just how I was feeling at that time. And I'm going to include that in my little time capsule. I'm also going to maybe put down, you know, some experiences I had with family over Zoom chatting for the first time, some virtual experiences, what it was like to see family through the screen instead of in person at times. You know, remembering when the lockdown actually took effect and what that felt like. What it was like to bring home my second Newfoundland dog, Herbie. He just turned one, by the way. He's a Christmas baby. He was born on Christmas Day, but we brought him home in March, just before the lockdown happened. So I definitely want to preserve and that feeling and what that was like. So I'm going to spend some time and I'm going to fill up my bag with memories and reflections and things from this past year, my time capsule. I challenge you to do the same. I think it might be really therapeutic. For those of you who love to write and keep diaries, this is really kind of a neat thing to do too. You know, just take a simple Christmas bag or something that you have, or a box or whatever. You know, take a few pieces of paper, write down some of your feelings from this past year and put them away and seal them up and don't touch them again for a year. In a year's time, when we open them up, that'll be something to really think about and pray over, things that we're thankful for, things that we're thankful God was in control of. You know, God, through all of this lockdown and everything, God has never wavered. He has been with us every step of the way. And you know, as much as we want with time capsules to preserve a moment of time, we have God who has given us the ultimate time capsule in the Bible. And that's a place to go and just lose yourself in and reflect and get involved in the scriptures and just imagine what it must have been like at that time. You know, what was it like in Jesus's birth and then Jesus's life? And then in this new year as we head into Easter, you know, how lucky we are to have the Bible as our time capsule. My friends, it is a new year. As you celebrate, may you also find just rest and relaxation and time together with those who mean the most to you. May you stay well. May you be well in mind and spirit and be with God. In Jesus, take care, everyone. God bless.
Hello. 今天的正道经文是马太福音第二章一到二节。当希律王的时候，耶稣生在犹太的伯利恒。有几位博士从东方来到耶路撒冷，说：“那生下来做犹太人之王的在哪里？我们在东方看见他的星，特来拜他。”希律王听见了，就心里不安。耶路撒冷合成的人也都不安。他就召集了祭司长和民间的文士，问他们说：“基督当生在何处？”他们回答说：“在犹太的伯利恒，因为有先知记着说：犹大地的伯利恒啊，你在犹大诸城中并不是最小的，因为将来有一位君王要从你那里出来，牧养我的以色列。”当下希律暗暗地招了博士来，细问那星是从什么时候出现的，就差他们往伯利恒去，说：“你们去仔细寻访那小孩子，寻到了就来报信，我也好去拜他。”他们听见王的话就去了。在东方所看见的那星忽然在他们前行，直行到小孩子的方向，就在上面停住了。他们看见那星就大大的欢喜，进了房子看见小孩子和他母亲玛利亚，就匍匐拜那小孩子，揭开宝盒，拿黄金、乳香、没药为礼物献给他。博士因为在梦中被主指示不要回去见希律，就从别的路回本地去了。当听圣灵向教会所说的话，感谢上帝。Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for another year of worshiping together. We ask for your continued presence and guidance in the coming year as we strive to tell the stories of our Christian faith. May these words, our thoughts, and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. A new year has begun, and at this time of year, we not only look forwards, but we also look backwards. In looking back, we often engage in year-end reviews and quizzes, And these quizzes seem to include a whole range of topics, from politics to finance to entertainment, a kind of year-end trivial pursuit. This morning, I thought we could engage in a kind of year-end wrap-up by covering some of the basics of our Christian faith. And we can do this in a fun kind of way by using the information from a simple song, a familiar song, the 12 Days of Christmas. This song presents a wide range of information, some that we often take for granted, and also some rare bits that are very much outside our normal experience. Most of us know the tune. Ross played it for us in our prelude. Thank you, Ross. I had long known that the 12 Days of Christmas was one of those secret code type of songs where everything has a double meaning, and each verse signifies some element of the Christian faith. These are called catechetical songs, like catechism or teaching songs. First of all, the 12 Days of Christmas extend from December 25th to January 5th. We are now on day 10 of Christmas. This is followed by the day of Epiphany, January 6th. And this is the day that the three wise men are traditionally supposed to have presented their gifts to Jesus. That day of Epiphany, January 6th, as you may know, is celebrated by many Europeans as Christmas or Little Christmas, and it's a traditional time to exchange gifts as well as on December 25th. Now the song, The 12 Days of Christmas, originated in England between the years 1558 and 1829, a period of 271 years, a long time to put a song together. During that time, Roman Catholic people were forbidden by law to practice their faith openly or publicly. So they put their teachings into a sort of code that would sound harmless, if not pointless, to any non-Catholic who chanced to overhear it. Quite clever, I would say. The song begins, "On the first day of Christmas, my true love sent to me." In the song, the speaker or the singer is an ordinary Christian. His true love is God. The song has a peculiar accumulative pattern in which each verse adds a new detail and then works its way back. This itself mirrors the way in which God, while continually giving fresh gifts to us, keeps on renewing every precious gift already given. So even the pattern of the song holds meaning. Just to review the symbols in the song, we have a partridge in a pear tree, two turtle doves, three French hens, four calling birds, five gold rings, six geese a-laying, seven swans a-swimming, eight maids a-milking, nine ladies dancing, 10 lords a-leaping, 11 pipers piping, and 12 drummers drumming. Now each of these symbols holds meaning. And when we start to think just a little more deeply about those symbols, even the most common ones, we would be surprised at how much we can learn from this song. For example, consider one of the simple ones, 10 lords a-leaping. The obvious link made here is the Ten Commandments. But I wonder, can you list all Ten Commandments? Originally, they were 10 brief words in Hebrew. No gods, no images, no oaths, keep Sabbath, honor parents, no murder, no adultery, no stealing, no perjury, and the last one that sounds so simple, but is probably the most difficult to keep, no coveting. The references in the other verses take a little more digging to find the details, but it is kind of fun. For example, seven swans a-swimming. These might correspond to the seven works of mercy, which I had never heard of. There are two groups of seven works in the history of the church. one group of corporeal or bodily works, and another of spiritual works. The seven corporeal works are feeding the hungry, giving drink to the thirsty, clothing the naked, harboring the stranger, visiting the sick, ministering to the prisoners, and burying the dead. The first six of these are listed in Matthew 25. The seven spiritual works are converting the sinner, instructing the ignorant, counseling the doubtful, comforting the sorrowful, bearing wrongs patiently, forgiving injuries, praying for the sick and the dead. Here we have two good sets of guidelines for any Christian congregation or community. As well, the seven swans of swimming could represent the seven loaves that were used to feed the multitude in one of many accounts of that miracle, or the seven baskets left over, or the total of five loaves and two fishes from the more familiar account. All of these referenced in the Gospels. Seven swans of swimming could also represent the seven gifts of the Spirit as listed in Corinthians 12. I wonder how many we can remember. There are wisdom, knowledge, faith, healing, miracles, prophecy, and tongues. Lots of references to seven. Nine ladies dancing, that's another good one. These could be the nine fruits of the Spirit, those things which grow from the seven spiritual gifts. Paul lists them in his letter to the Galatians as being love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Another interesting group of nine are the ranking of the angels. Most of us have heard of seraphims and cherubims, but there are also thrones, dominations, virtues, and powers, and then another group of angels called principalities, archangels, and simply angels. Nine groups. Only the last two were considered to have any contact with people, according to medieval theology. Two turtle doves could be the Old and New Testaments, or the bread and the cup. Three French hens, a valuable gift. It could be the wise man's gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Or they might represent the prime Christian virtues of faith, hope, and love. Four calling birds, the four gospel writers calling to us, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Or perhaps the major Old Testament prophets, again who called, Elijah, Jeremiah, Isaiah, and Ezekiel. Six geese a-laying represent the productivity of the first 6 days of creation, which the song continually reminds us are continually recreating and being made new. Still with me? Eight maids of milking. In those times, there were a minimum of eight times a year that Roman Catholics were supposed to take communion. Or the eight maids of milking could represent the Beatitudes or the blessings that are found in the fifth chapter of Matthew. I wonder if we can list all those blessings and who they are for. There are blessings for the poor, for those who mourn, for those who are meek, for those who seek righteousness, for those who are merciful, for those who are pure in heart, for the peacemakers, and for the persecuted. In the Gospel of Luke, there are four blessings and four matching woes, again, a total of eight. 11 pipers piping. That's an easy one. The 11 faithful disciples. But I wonder, how many can we name? There are the familiar ones, the brothers, Peter and Andrew, the other brothers, James and John. There's Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, another James, Simon, and Thaddeus. All the names are listed in the Gospels. 12 drummers drumming. Here are the 12 minor prophets of the Old Testament, Some of them are familiar, like Jonah, Amos, Hosea. There's also Joel, Obadiah, and Micah. And then there's some interesting names like Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. Or the 12 drummers drumming could be the 12 points of the Apostles' Creed. And you can find that in the back of your hymn books, page 918. Or they could be the 12 gates of the heavenly city of the New Jerusalem that we find described in the Revelation to John, chapter 21. But the key verses of the song are verses 5 and 1, where the timing, the rhythm, and the tempo change to give added emphasis to these key verses. 5 gold rings could refer to the rings of someone like the Pope. Or they could be the 5 sacraments of the faithful Catholics at that time. These were baptism, confirmation, the Eucharist or Lord's Supper, penance, and extreme unction, which means anointing with oil. In our United Church, we have 2 sacraments, baptism and the Lord's Supper, or communion as we call it here. But most probably, the 5 gold rings referred to the first 5 books of the Hebrew Bible, the books of the law, or the Torah: Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. These 5 books were summed up by Jesus in what is often called the Golden Rule: do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Finally, where do we find Christ within this song? Otherwise, it really is just a game of Trivial Pursuit. Well, the first gift from a Christian true love is a partridge in a pear tree. To the artists of the Middle Ages, a mother partridge seemed like a symbol of Christ because she would often act as a decoy to lure a predator away from her young, who were almost as defenseless as we are before the evil that can so easily overpower us. From a distance, a pear tree looks not unlike an apple tree, whose forbidden fruit Adam unwisely digested. Thus, both the bird and the tree make it their business to mislead the unwary. Only when you come close do you see that you are dealing not with the first Adam, who made use of a tree to mar humankind, but rather with the second Adam, the Christ, who used a different kind of tree, the cross, to redeem the whole of the human race. The bird and the tree. These 2 linked symbols of deception serve for more than 2 centuries to conceal the importance of the song from people who were not supposed to see what it was driving at. Quite a symbol for Christ, the partridge in a pear tree. Deceptively plain, easy to see, but elusive except through faith. Quite a song, the 12 days of Christmas, a song that reveals our faith and reminds us to live in gratitude for all the gifts that we have been given. Thanks be to God for the gift of Christ Jesus, and that we don't need to speak in secret code any longer, and that, like those wise men, we are free to pursue our faith journeys, and that we are free to proclaim our belief in Jesus the Christ, who came to live among us. Amen. Now let's sing this carol that we've all been talking about, the 12 days of Christmas.
On the first day of Christmas, my true love sent to me a partridge in a pear tree. On the second day of Christmas, my true love sent to me two turtle doves and a partridge in a pear tree.
Please join me for the prayer after the offering. We too, like the wise men, bring our gifts most rare, hearts full of yearning, hands wanting to help, financial resources to support a place of worship, and outreach projects that bring a ray of hope to people's lives. May the light of the wise men's star be reflected in our gifts, O God, that others may know of the light and of the love that the Christ child brings to our life and to our world. Amen.
Let us pray. God of light, we give thanks that we are part of a community that has a wonderful story of love and faithfulness, forgiveness, and sharing. We give thanks that we are on a journey shared by many companions who also believe in you. Like the wise men, we travel searching to see you and to be with you and to bring you the gift of ourselves. We give thanks that we are not alone, and that you are with us in all our experiences and emotions, in the excitement and joy of new beginnings, new relationships, new ideas and insights, new babies and new homes. In the anger and fear of losing a job, a family member, a friend. In the mixed feelings of moving, of decision making, of new jobs, in the midst of routines of study, of work, of retirement. Thank you, God, that you are always reaching out to us, seeking relationship, knocking at the doors of our hearts, wanting to be part of our lives. Loving God, we know that many people do not have the stability of faith to sustain them, and we pray for them now. We pray also for the people caught in the midst of wars and violence not of their own making, for the many people who are hungry and malnourished, for people who have no home or even a roof over their heads, for people without access to clean water. We pray for people who have been or are abused in their homes, in the streets, or by the systems of our culture. We pray that all people may have dignity, peace, justice, and loving relationships. This morning, God, we continue to pray especially for the people battling COVID-19, for their caregivers, their families, and their loved ones. We pray for sound leadership as we move forward. Finally, God, as we pray together for the first time in this new year, we ask that you give us the courage to risk making changes in ourselves, our families, our church, and our world, so that your vision may be fulfilled. In Jesus' name, amen.
Of his love and wonders of his love and wonders.
And now into this new year we move, confident of God's love for us, convinced of Christ's companionship with us, certain that the nudging, leading spirit of life will guide us. Let us go in peace and in love to serve God in all the places that life calls us to be. Amen.